powered by passion. It's National Auto Care's Fixed Ops 5 with your host, National Fixed Operations Training Manager, Corey Smith.
Welcome to Fixed Ops 5. I'm your host, Corey Smith. Today, I'm being joined by Steve Apicella, who is the CEO of Strategic DX. Before we get into this episode, which I'm super excited about, Steve, tell us a little elevator version of your work history. What got you to this point?
Hey, Corey, thanks. Really grateful to be on here. Before I get started, I wanted to mention a couple of things. One is, I really appreciate your role with NAC and the contribution you're making to the industry, which a lot of times is forgotten about. A lot of people are really focused on, let's sell something, but don't put a lot of horsepower into how it's serviced. And NAC and you have definitely made that a focal point in your business model. I know the field appreciates it and the dealer appreciates it. I appreciate it.
Well, thank you.
I think it's brilliant. Yeah, and I love your podcast here. You're doing a great job with it.
Thank you.
So, you know, I think for a lot of people, you know, I don't know that anybody starts off wanting to be in the auto industry. And I also think, you know, I've heard people say this before, which I really appreciate too, that the path to success for most people is not a straight line, it's a squiggly line. And that's certainly true for me. I've had crossroads and pivots along the way. I feel absolutely blessed to be where I'm at today and what we're doing and this purpose-driven mission that we're doing. But my exposure to the automotive industry started decades ago. I was recruited by a retail company. And again, I won't tell the long version of this, but purchased a vehicle, had my car in the parking lot, got hit by a shopping cart.
Oh, no.
And it was almost brand new. And, having that perspective as a consumer and a young man with a cool car, I was beside myself, angry, in fact, that it occurred. And took it immediately to a body shop where they told me they're going to weld a stud on it and pull it out and grind it and Bondo it and repaint it. And I'm like, not my car. And I was naive. I didn't know how the process worked. So after kind of jawing with the body shop manager for a while, he said, all right, kid, you know, there's this guy that does paint-free dent repair, which is what it was called in its infancy decades ago. We now call it paintless dent repair. He suggested I'll have this guy come out, take a look at it, and see if he can do something. So I met this guy the following week. And this is back in the day where it was like a proprietary process where the guy put screens up so you couldn't see the work actually being done. He wasn't trying to mask me from it, but the body shops, nobody would steal his technique, which is pretty funny. And then to watch this guy attempt without body work to push the dent out from the window channel. It was in the door and leverage it out. And he ended up wrecking it and I had to have the car bondoed anyway. But there was something in my head, a loose screw or call it entrepreneurial spirit or something. Probably the lines that differentiate those two are pretty narrow. But I thought, boy, if you could do that process well, that could really be something. So fast forward a decade and my wife and I are running a company of technicians nationwide. And I had a long learning curve. I mean, I had to learn this myself, the discipline in my garage. Remember that decades ago, there's no owner's manual. There's no YouTube, no internet. No, you just got to figure it out, you know? So I had to literally trial and error until I got it. And then started servicing car dealerships and then growing this network of technicians throughout the United States. And it wasn't until 2001 when I was exposed to the F&I side of the industry as a vendor, as a service provider, when the F&I community created what we now know as ancillary products. Mm-hmm. It started that in the early 2000s with a paintless dent repair warranty. And because of our national footprint and our plug and play ability, we became really popular really fast with a lot of third party administrators to fulfill the service, which is very different than a mechanical service contract.
Oh, okay.
So when these things started to get sold, third party administrators assumed, boy, we'll just use the same mechanism we're using now for mechanical. But the difference is, there's not a room full of paintless dent repair technicians waiting to fix the next car at the dealer, like in the image behind you. There's a room full of mechanics there to fix mechanical issues. So the engagement of this was clunky in the beginning until they found ways to fulfill this at the dealer and beyond the dealer to take care of these customers, wherever they may be when they get a dent. Hmm. And it was because of that experience, I went into it pretty naively myself, Corey, where I thought, you know, hey, I'm going to get more work. More people are going to learn about what I do. I assume I'm going to get paid. What could possibly go wrong? And my experience taught me a lot. A lot went wrong. The information that we received in claims back then, fax on the thermal fax roll, pulling it off the fax machine.
Oh, I remember that.
Yeah. A lot of times there was missing information. There wasn't contact information. The information that got to us was slow. And almost always the damage reported when we looked at the car in person was wrong.
Okay.
So there was a disconnect there. And the more we did this, the more apparent that disconnect of process became clearer and clearer and clearer. And I started off in Chicago, Midwestern guy, and you know, our spirit is to be a part of the solution and not part of the problem. So I started to engage these third-party administrators to address this clear process issue. And what I found was a lot of reluctancy, it shocked me. They're like, hey, listen, we're the administrator. You're the dent guy. You fix dents. We administer claims. You stay in your lane. We'll stay in ours. Mm-hmm. But the process was really bad, to the point of almost 8 out of 10 claims that we received that were approved by the administrator were either not repairable using PDR or not covered under the warranty.
So you basically fixed that going forward, right?
And that was kind of where it went, you know, to me, it was really clear that there was a major process problem, which led to a major experience problem for the dealer and the customer and for us, the technician.
Hmm. Well,
Go ahead.
Let's jump into this topic, which I think we'll title it customer experience. Who's responsible, right? And I've heard you talk about this many times, customer experience before. And, you know, that's the basis of this episode. How can the dealership provide a gold standard customer experience after the sale in your mind?
Well, and what you said there is really important, because that's the part that's often missed. Like I acknowledge with your position at NAC is the industry is really good at selling stuff, right? Selling mm-hmm. contracts, really good at that. Selling cars, really good at that. But the engagement process after the point of sale, there's a lot of people that, you know, should have a stake in this. The third party administrators certainly have a stake in it.
Oh yeah.
Their agents have a stake in it. The employees at the dealership, because all that leads to a good experience or not. So when you think about this, you know, after the point of sale, and the industry likes to talk about F&I products being a retention tool. Well, retention only occurs when you have a great experience.
Mm-hmm.
So think about how this happens today. A customer, you know, how many of them ever read their service contract or warranty?
Zero.
Almost none, right? Now, it's not even good reading on a bad day. You know, it's just people don't do it. They don't have time to do it in the F&I experience. And they certainly, when they get home, don't open up that folder and start investigating the warranties or service contracts.
No, as soon as they get home, they want to show their friends, their family, look at my new car, smell it. You know, look
exactly,
at the paint.
Right. They're excited about it. And truthfully, they want to get out of the dealership so they can do that, right?
Right.
Like, let's get on the road. Let's start enjoying the new car. Or you always say new as a matter of perspective.
Right. New to me.
Your own car is new to a customer too, right? Yeah. And they're proud of that generally too.
Yeah.
So JD. To clarify that though, what happens is when a customer doesn't read their service contract or warranty, they'll intuitively show up to a service drive just like behind you right now, unannounced. And they're greeted by a service advisor that welcomes them to the dealer, and the customer says, hey, I bought my car here. I bought some protection products. I need service support. Now, the position that we put service advisors in today is terrible because at that point, the customer bought the car there and they bought these F&I products there. What is a service advisor equipped with? Nothing. You know, they have no idea what was sold in the finance office. And, you know, rhetorically, I ask, how many times does a service advisor learn about what's being sold in the finance office for the first time when a customer's standing in front of them requesting service from it,
yeah.
right? This kind of interaction happens every day, but that doesn't promote a good experience because the service advisor either has to say, hey, what products did you buy from us? Do you know the company name? Do you have a copy of your warranty with you? Do you have your contract number with you? And of course the customer doesn't.
No,
their expectation is, hey, I bought this stuff from you. Right. You should know.
You should know, not me.
Right.
Right.
So that we're not doing a great job. You know, it's irrefutable, Corey, that customers overwhelmingly don't like the car buying process today. And most customers that do buy a car are not returning to their selling dealer.
Yeah.
And we really have to be reflective about that. Why is it occurring? You know, and all be a part of this. You know, I think the support community is, and I'm included in that, and so are you.
Yeah. Right.
The support community is there to help empower the dealer to solve those problems that lead to more revenue and more retention. And that's part of, you know, everybody has a stake in it, including the agents, including the dealers. We're in this thing together.
Yeah, I mean, that's a great way to put that. And, you know, J.D. Power says 62% of customers say they're willing to pay more money for a better experience.
Exactly.
And your Gen Y customers believe customer service experience is 3 times more important than the actual vehicle design. I mean, those are big stats. So if we stop and complaining...
Let me add one more thing, Corey, to that.
Yeah, go ahead.
Sometimes it's a misnomer about digital engagement. Digital engagement, even though that statistic is very important, is not just a millennial or a Gen Z topic. In 2021 and moving forward, it's anybody with a smartphone in their hand topic.
100%.
This is all generations.
Yeah.
You know, and Amazon's the best example of that is Amazon's not a generational thing. Everybody generation, it's not a matter of if they've purchased, it's how often they've purchased through Amazon. And the great part about that, to your point, the statistic you just said, is today Amazon's not the cheapest resource online anymore.
No, they're not.
But people go back there again and again and again and again because of the experience that they deploy. This is the important part, before and after the sale. That's what makes them so transformative. And something that the industry can learn from. And I think this too, you know, I heard somebody say this earlier today, which I appreciate. You know, when we look at things like Blockbuster Video and Netflix, right? People point to that all the time. That's not intended to be a threat. That's a lesson, or should be a lesson for the automotive industry. It doesn't mean the industry has to follow in those footsteps. It certainly means that it should learn from what occurred there that took this titan. And, you know, people like to say Netflix killed Blockbuster. That's not true. Blockbuster killed Blockbuster.
Correct.
And again, is there a direct correlation with that, with the auto industry? I don't know, but there's certainly a lesson to be learned there for everybody in this industry.
Yeah. And I think as a community in the auto world, we need to stop complaining and actually try to lift everybody up to give the customer that great experience. Just like you just mentioned it, Amazon, Disney is another one that comes to mind. You know, your hotel industry, there are some that are above expectations, right? So
it's another mistake, though, Corey, just I'm sorry to jump in there. It's another mistake to think that it's digital transformation or die.
Right. No,
I don't agree with that. You know, digital transformation is intended, the right ones are intended to remove the analog pain points that strain the dealer customer relationship. It's not intended to tell the dealer to close their front door.
Right.
I'm a digital guy, and that's not what I'm conveying to you or to the industry. The two can coexist. It's not throw away all the best practices of the dealer. In fact, what we have to do is we have to embrace the things that make the traditional brick and mortar dealer unique compared to the 100% online retailer. That's the mission. And technology is certainly a part of that, but not a magic bullet.
Yeah. So, you answered my next question, which is who is responsible for providing this experience? It's everybody, right?
Everybody.
The customers are changing. You know, millennials want technology. You just said it. Everybody with a smartphone wants the option of that technology. So other generations, almost 50% of millennials surveyed said they want technology when buying a service contract and buying and servicing their car. So it's that old saying that sales sells the first car and service sells the second car. So a positive service experience is more important. It's 85% of what customers state their expectations and their experiences. If they experience a good experience with the service department, they're influenced likely to buy their next vehicle with that service department. So how can a dealership leverage this technology to give the customer the best experience to keep them coming back over and over and over again?
This is the profound difference, Corey. It's a great question, between digital retailing and digital lifecycle. They're two very different topics. You know, digital retailing, which we don't do, by the way, but I'm a huge advocate for. Digital retailing is just another conduit to acquire a customer. It's not the conduit. It's a conduit to acquire a customer that's digitally minded. But here's the thing about digital retailing, which again, I think is important. The digital experience that is associated with digital retailing abruptly ends at, or most of the time, before the point of vehicle sale. And then afterwards, our industry is delivering digital abandonment. What does that experience tell the customer? And this is a huge thing you got to make the connection to. Is the auto retailing industry's mission, is it to sell a car exclusively or to also earn a reoccurring customer? Now, if the latter is true, what are we telling customers when we digitally abandon them after the point of sale? I think that translates to them that, hey, the transaction is over and therefore our relationship's over.
Yeah.
Right?
When it's really just beginning.
It really should be just beginning. I know that's the sentiment for everybody, but when dealers are trying to communicate with their customers with phone solicitations and junk mail, whether that's postal or email or even random text messages, we're sending communications that customers overwhelmingly view as fraud, or at least we've conditioned them that those are fraudulent communications.
Yeah.
So this is the challenge for the industry. It's not if we're trying to connect, but how we're connecting that makes the relationship work or not. And, you know, I think that's part of it. You know, when we look at, Corey, and I know you feel strongly about this too, in the automotive retailing segment, we like to break these things up, variable ops and fixed ops. That's a behind the scenes thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to a customer, this is one ownership journey.
Yep.
It happens to 100%. Navigate through multiple departments at a dealership, but we got to start looking at it through the customer's lens and not through our industry's lens about what that's supposed to translate to a customer. It should be one frictionless, continuous journey all the way through their ownership experience so we can earn them back in the service drive. And I use the word earn very selectively, earn them back to buy another car. And this is the thing that's irrefutable again, is the retention rate in our industry is horrendous.
Mm-hmm.
And we can't just think that the analog processes that we've always used can be refined and somehow that's gonna take care of it.
So
customer is always changing. I want to say one more thing. I apologize for cutting you off, but this is important to me.
Okay.
Corey, the customers are, as you mentioned, the customers are already there. And most dealers are mentally already there too. It's the support community that's got to rally here. You know, the dealers are looking for the support community to provide the solutions, not to support the problems. And that's right. What we have to do. You know, when I look at a third-party administrator and I happen to be talking to a representative of one that understands it, you know, should a customer have intuitive access to their dealer and to their purchase service contracts, even if there's multiple administrators and a rewards program and buying more service contracts or warranty after the point of sale, all on their smartphone in 2021? Most people would say, of course.
Yeah.
But how much of our industry actually supports that?
Not very many.
It's really, really low. And that's where, again, the challenge is incumbent on us, that we all know the problem, right? If we're the support community is going to prevail, you know, who should lead these kind of transformations? The support community. We have a choice. And I do think, you know, I said it a little earlier, I'll be even more direct about this. The customer's always changing. Right. Dealers always changing. That's not exclusive to the pandemic or exclusive to 2021. If you would have asked me that question in 1995, I would tell you the customer's changing. Right. That's just a reality of evolution with customer expectations. But today, because of everything that's happened, I think you are either a part of the solution or you're part of the disconnected from reality problem. And there is no in between. There is no sidelines. Either you're propelling what's next or you're supporting what was.
Yeah. So if I hear you correctly, it's not just get a digital tool and all your problems are going to go away. You really need to learn how to leverage that so that you can have after sales engagement or selling something maybe that they said no to, and letting them know that the journey is just beginning, in your own words, not ending, right?
Put a clear stake in the ground. You know, the first message digitally, push notification, highest engagement rate on a customer's smartphone, in my opinion, should be thanks for buying a car from us. Yeah. Welcome to the family. We're looking forward to being on this journey with you. To put that clear stake in the ground that selling you a car was not the end, it's just the beginning. And the same thing too, messages can be sent out from service directors. Again, welcome that customer to the family and let me show you how this dealership can uniquely support you better than anybody during your ownership journey. You know, there's a lot of times that customers after the point of sale, why didn't you go back to the dealer? Why didn't you buy that service contract if you survey them? And right. Most of the time they'll say, I wasn't even aware.
Didn't know.
So
to kind of wrap this up in a bow, what are your three takeaways from this episode in your mind that a service advisor, an agent, an outside vendor, someone in the leadership of the dealership can take away from this episode? Three little nuggets that you can give them.
I would say digital engagement is not a fad. It's a reality. And although it's not the magic bullet, there needs to be evolution and thought at the dealership in a way that we support a customer on their ownership journey. And that includes buying a car and supporting that journey after the point of sale. And then hopefully, again, earning the next customer for that dealership. But again, take a sobering look at the statistics in our industry. It's not good. Loyalty is not good in our industry right now. And we have to evolve that. I think that's really important. Yeah. I also believe that, you know, the very name of our industry, the auto retailing industry, is something that we have to understand what the purpose is. Are we just trying to retail something? Are we just trying to sell a car to a customer? And if we're lucky, a service contract in the F&I environment? Or are we trying to earn a customer so that all of those revenue touch points continue after the point of sale? And this, again, is where I challenge is our end game, even in digital, is it digital retailing, which abruptly ends at or before the point of sale, or is it digital life cycle throughout the customer's ownership experience with the dealer? And the other part, you know, Corey, I would say too is, you know, leadership is something that a lot of people, it's one of those words that, you know, get thrown around a lot. Leaders are not contemplating if it's a good idea to enable and to democratize dealer customer engagement on their smartphone. Leadership is delivering it.
Yeah. No, and I like those points quite a bit. Yeah. So if you want to deliver a legendary customer experience that keeps the customer coming back to you and encouraging them to invite their friends, their family into your establishment, then you've caught the gold standard of customer service, that vision that we're talking about today. Do you want a more cohesive team that delivers a higher level of customer service that will result in more revenue for your dealership? Of course you do. We provide the tools, the knowledge, training needed to unlock that potential of your dealership. For more information on this topic and other topics, or to submit a question or to be a guest on the show, feel free to send me an email, csmith@nationalautocare.com. Steve, that's all the time that we have for today. I want to thank you for being on this episode. Next episode, Steve, we're going to talk about employee experience and retention, which I know is near and dear to your heart as well. Looking forward to talking again. Thank you so much for carving out time. I know you're a CEO and you've got tons of other things to do, but the listeners appreciate it, and I certainly appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Always time for this, Corey. Thank you. Appreciate you.
Thank you for watching and listening to National Auto Care's Fixed Ops 5 with Corey Smith, powered by Passion. Be sure to watch and listen to the next episode on the 5th and 20th of every month.